Happy Easter. I'm Pastor Adam. Welcome to Holy Cross, our worship online for this, our Easter celebration. Man, it is so cool to be able to worship together and connect with you. We're so thankful that we have the connection of the Holy Spirit, that no matter where we are, as we open His Word, as we sing His praises together, He is at work in it all. And I trust that that's true today as much as any other day. A few announcements as we get going here today. Some Bible studies, one that's new and two that are continuing. We talked about this last week, but I want you to be aware that the women's Bible study that's called, that's on bad girls of the Bible, that starts this coming Saturday. So if you haven't yet got your book or put the order in for that, you need to do that right away and sign up and join us, or not join us, join that group on Saturday morning here at church at 9 o'clock to work through the first chapter of that book. More details in your Friday email for all of that. That one will happen second and fourth Saturdays at 9 o'clock. The other two that are continuing on is the men's Friday morning Bible study. That's both Zoom and in person, and continues to study the things of either the message of the previous week or the podcast from the previous week, a chance to dig in and have conversation about those things, as well as a Tuesday morning Bible study, that one middle of the morning, and that's on 1 Corinthians and happens via Zoom. Another new thing that's coming up is that later on in April, starting the 20th, will be walks in the park. Now, in the past, that has been a women's ministry thing, but it's open wider now, so men and women, feel free to come out and be a part of this. So couples, you can join us, or fellas, come on out on your own. Either way, it's a chance to walk at your own pace. There's probably somebody that's of similar speed and pace to you, and it's a chance to get together and enjoy our community and enjoy one another's company. So expect all those things as you come to Walks in the Park starting April 20th. The last thing I want to invite you into is next week we'll start a new series on forgiveness, something we talk about often but struggle with regularly. And we'll be digging into some of the biggest questions. In fact, we polled those of you that are a part of HC Community, our private Facebook page, what your questions are about forgiveness to help as we thought about shaping that series. We look forward to addressing the things that are on your minds and forgiveness. With that, I with joy share with you the beginning of our service for today. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Let's sing.
Jesus Christ is risen today.
Have procured. Alleluia.
angels ever sing. Alleluia. Sing we to our God above. Alleluia. Praise eternal as his love. Alleluia. Praise him.
As we begin this day of celebration, we do so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. God, for our redemption, you gave your only begotten Son to the death on a cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of the enemy. Grant that all our sin may be drowned through daily repentance, and that day by day we may arise to live before you in righteousness and purity forever through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We agree and say together, amen. Today is a day to raise our voices, to proclaim victory over sin, death, and the devil. Today is a day of rejoicing, for today is a day when the grave is empty, for he is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Yet even today, it's vital to remember why Jesus was in the grave at all. His death was his loving gift to rescue us from our sin, to rescue us from ourselves. Jesus died the death we deserve so that we could live the life we don't deserve. With this truth in mind, let us together confess our sin again to our loving Father in heaven. Take a few quiet moments to confess what's on your heart, and then we'll speak together. Most merciful God, we confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have failed to love you and our neighbor as ourselves. We deserve your punishment, yet we hold on to the truth that Jesus came into the world not to condemn it, but to save it. Save us, we pray. Rescue us, we pray. Forgive us, we pray, in Jesus' name. The prophet Isaiah reminds us, Jesus took up our pain and bore our suffering. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. St. Paul exclaims, the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law, but thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. The resurrection of Christ Jesus is proof that God makes good on his word as a called and ordained servant of the word. And by the command and with the authority of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
The resurrection. let's celebrate.
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 16th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. After the Sabbath, at dawn, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him, they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid, yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
I was buried beneath my shame. was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive, and my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all. And I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You call my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. My sins were heavy, chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name,
grace and peace be upon you from God our Father and our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Christ is risen. He has risen indeed. Alleluia. Friends, this phrase that Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, alleluia, is not just something we say every Easter, though we do that. But friends, this proclamation is both a war cry and a cry of victory. You see, it's a cry of victory, for we know now, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that death has been conquered and that the grave has no sting. We know now, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that we will rise to new life. We know now, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that there is a new heavens and a new earth. And we know now, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that all sickness will cease and tears will no longer be needed. We know now, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And yet, friends, this is also our war cry. For until our death or until Jesus returns, we are in the midst of a battle. A battle in which our enemy prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. Death is still a reality for you and for me. There are still tears.
there is still sickness and disease, and it would be easy to be overwhelmed by our present circumstances. And so we cry aloud, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia, to stir up hope, allowing it to pull us into the Father's future. And so, friends, whether this is a victory cry or a war cry, this is good news. Amen? Amen. Sisters and brothers, I want to take a brief moment and just thank all of those whose service makes our celebration of Easter possible. To musicians and tech operators, to Altar Guild and deacons, to Larry and a cleaning crew, to the staff at Holy Cross, and to an incredible partner in ministry, Pastor Adam. Friends, we say thank you. Thank you for what it is you do. What happens here today, what happens in our worship today is made possible through the creativity and time and care of so many people. And so we say, thank you. And much has happened in a week's time. We've had the triumphal entry of a king coming to meet his people, trying to throw him a coronation. We've had an intimate Passover celebration with his closest disciples, fleshing out the final details of mission and ministry through a foot washing and a meal designed to power the disciples into the mission ahead. A night of concerted prayer, laboring for unity as the calling card of his followers, laboring in prayer to the point of sweating blood and soaking the ground with prayers and tears. An early morning arrest, a trial, a sentencing, bearing the weight of his own cross through the streets of Jerusalem, being paraded around like a criminal. He's hung to die, buried in the borrowed tomb of a compassionate Pharisee, and a stone, a mighty stone, is rolled into place, sealing the body of Jesus in the ground, a sure and certain evidence that his story is over. In fact, I imagine that if that gravestone could talk, it would say, it is finished. Nobody leaves this space. This would-be king has no authority here. In fact, I'm the authority now. He bows to me. So go away. Let your hope die and never return. This is the mindset of the women as they return on the day after the Sabbath. In fact, Matthew in his gospel records that Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. They want to look at it. They want to see if their worst dreams have come true. They want to stare at the rock which blocks the entrance to the tomb and by extension, the exit of Jesus. So they returned to the tomb with the finality of all of that gravestone had to say on that Good Friday, that death is the ultimate authority, that it is the inevitable end for all mankind. Every generation tastes it. Every family must confront it. Every person bears in their flesh its eventual sting. Death comes to us all. Even for kings, it comes. You see, this monster called death is simply the consequence of disobedience to God's word. As St. Paul says, death comes to everyone because of what one man did. You see, there at the beginning of days, our loving Father, he provided all that we needed. He had breathed everything we know into existence, given us freedom to live under his provision and goodness, to live as representatives to the whole of creation, as his prized possession, as his greatest handiwork, as the only thing in all of creation that bears his image. We were given to live under his gracious rule. And yet, Adam and Eve were deceived by Satan, and they gave in to their own desires to be like God, to be the ruler of their own worlds. So rather than trust God at his word, they chose to go their own way. The consequences have reverberated throughout history. God says in Genesis 3, by the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you will return. What's God saying here? He's saying life will be work, and work will no longer be a joy for you, but actually a chore, and you will toil in your life until you die. until the body you bear returns to the ground and the gravestone is rolled into place and your grave laughs with its authority. Centuries later, King Solomon, the wisest of kings, would say, what do people get for all the toil and the anxious striving with which they labor under the sun? All of their days and work is just grief and pain. I mean, King Solomon would go on to say, it's a chasing after the wind. Why? Because at the end of the day, there is an end of days. In other words, death comes to us all. It is the inevitable end of all mankind. Every generation tastes it. Every family must confront it. Every person bears in their flesh its eventual sting. Or, as King David would say, the cords of the grave have coiled around me. The snares of death have confronted me. So you and me, friends, you and I, we too will taste death. Now, some of us know that we're closer than others, while others of us are close and we don't know it. Death stings. And having felt that sting, Mary Magdalene and this other Mary, they head to the tomb of Jesus to once again see the finality of death and to hear the echo of Good Friday, to hear the laughter of the grave. But unbeknownst to them, mighty events have taken place, literally a tectonic shift of authority. Matthew records it this way. He says, there was a mighty earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, he rolled back the stone and he sat on it. See, that Easter morning, there was a tremor in the earth. In the dust and the rock of the earth, the ground shook. The borrowed grave of Joseph of Arimathea, it quivered in anticipation. Imagine for just a moment the thought process of that gravestone, who days ago mocked the king buried within her, as that gravestone heard the beating of Jesus' heart as it thundered through the silence. Imagine the wondering of the gravestone as it watches a chest rise and fall with every new breath. Imagine its wondering as Jesus opens his eyes in the dark, whose lips once cracked and chapped now crack a smile. Imagine its bewilderment as Jesus winks at that gravestone as if he knows some joke that the gravestone doesn't. Imagine the gravestone staring in amazement and the shift of its gaze as it watches heaven come to earth, an angel of the Lord descending with a mighty thud. Imagine its unbelievable thought process in that last effort as the angel begins to roll open the grave. And imagine in its last effort to keep its prisoner buried in the ground, to look back and to see nothing but emptiness, to see an empty grave, a grave with no body. And now looking back and forth between an empty grave and the angel whose smile is as wide as the east is from the west. Imagine its wonder as it overhears the angel say, "Do not be afraid, for I know you are looking for Jesus. He is not crucified. He is not here. He is risen just as he said. And so come and see the place where he lay." Imagine the astonishment of the grave as Mary and Mary enter and wonder and realize that death and the grave no longer has authority. I mean, you can almost hear the grave say, "Is this true? Is this for real? Has someone actually defeated the power that I once held? Has someone actually conquered death in a way no one in all of history has done? Has this man changed reality? Has this man altered death? Has this man, by his death, actually given life?" I mean, you can almost feel the earth tremble with this new reality, as grave after grave after grave give itself over to the power of the resurrection. It is now the grave which bows in reverence to the power and the authority of Jesus. This is how St. Paul can declare that the perishable will put on the imperishable, that the mortal will put on immortality, or from the top of his lungs declare, "Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?" The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he says, he gives us the victory through Jesus Christ. See, as the rock and the gravestones cry out to you and me today, they say, you may stop in the grave, but you are not held there forever. For this Jesus, in whom you believe, has made the grave simply a resting place until he calls us by name. Friends, we hold on to the truth when Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life, and the one who believes in me will live even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. This is the good news of Easter Sunday, that because he is risen, so to us, death doesn't get the last laugh, Jesus does. Now Matthew picks up his gospel by saying, so the women, they hurried away from the tomb, afraid and yet filled with joy. And they ran and they told his disciples. And suddenly Jesus meets them. Greetings, he says to them. And they came to him. They clasped his feet and they worshiped him. Filled with joy, sisters and brothers in Christ, like those women on that early Sunday morning, who when looking into the grave can only see life, are filled with joy. Let us leave this day. Let us walk away this day with joy, knowing that we have a Savior who goes before us. Let us leave this place filled with joy, knowing that we have a Savior who would die and rise in power so that we can die and rise in his power too. And sisters and brothers, until Jesus returns, let us, like the women that early Easter morning, let us worship. Let us bow down at the feet of Jesus. Let us lift up praise and song to him. Let us offer our lives as living sacrifices. Let us worship as we go into the world with this incredible Easter news that Christ is risen. Let us go into the world proclaiming the hope we have in the resurrection, proclaiming eternal life, which is ours in Christ Jesus, proclaiming that death has no authority over us, proclaiming that Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life. You know, I wonder, friends, I wonder if the graves that we will one day lie in have something to say. I mean, perhaps they'll look at you and perhaps they'll look at me. And they'll look a little closer and they'll see Jesus in us and say to themselves, welcome, not to death, but to new life in him. I'm reminded of this story when Peter is asked who Jesus is, and Peter declares, you are the Messiah. You are the Christ. You are the anointed one. And Jesus says, you are Peter. You are Petros, that word which means little rock. You are a little rock. Built on the big rock, built on me. And the promise is this, that the gates of hell will not prevail. Sisters and brothers, as we go this day into all the world with the good news of Easter, we go as little rocks whose very lives become an assault against the gates of hell. Against the grave, against death, and the promises it will not prevail. If the rocks could cry out, they'd cry out, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And now, friends, may the peace of God, which surpasses all of our human understanding, may guard and keep our hearts in Christ Jesus. This resurrected Christ Jesus today and every day. Amen.
The angel rolled the stone away. The angel rolled the stone away. 'Twas on a bright and shiny morn, when the trumpets began to sound, the angel rolled the stone away. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Alleluia, 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 Christ is risen. Alleluia, 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 Christ is risen. Alleluia, 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 Christ is risen. Jesus, he was killed on a Friday. Jesus, he lay buried and dead. Jesus, he arose on the third day. He rose up into heaven, just like he said. Go tell Mary and Martha.
Go tell Mary and Martha.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Father, won't you ever believe me? Sister, do you think it's a lie? Listen, let me tell you a story. If you believe in Jesus, then you'll never die.
Go tell Mary and Martha.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Alleluia, 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 Christ is risen. The angel rolled the stone away. The angel rolled the stone away. 'Twas on a bright and shiny morn, when the trumpet began to sound, the angel rolled the stone away. The angel rolled the stone away. The angel rolled the stone away.
Let's speak our faith together, but not in the words of the Nicene Creed or the Apostles' Creed, one that's particular to what's joyous for today, our Easter Creed. Let's speak it together. This is the gospel which we have received, in which we stand, and by which we are saved. We hold it fast, that Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, that he appeared first to the women, and then to Peter, and to the 12, and then to many faithful witnesses. We believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus Christ is the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He is our Lord, our Savior, and our God. Amen. Let's sing.
He lives, he lives.
Would you join me in prayer? Father, we know that because of Jesus' death and resurrection, you are with us, you are for us, and you love us. As it says in the Psalms, the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. Lord, that your ears are attentive to our cries. That the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Lord, you care for us. It's why you sent your Son in the first place. You grieved with us of a world filled with sin and sent him in order that we might be healed from it, that it might break into this world. And so we pray, Lord, that that same power would break into our lives already now, not just at the end, already now. Turn your eyes to us. Hear our cry on behalf of all who are discouraged. This is a day of celebration, but Lord, there are challenges in life. There are new and ever-changing ones in the midst of COVID and all that comes along with that. Lord, turn your eyes to all who are mourning, the ones who are no longer near to them, the ones that they can't be near to. Lord, turn your eyes to all who are feeling hopeless, all who feel helpless, all who are hurt. Father, we lift to you those who need healing for their bodies, peace for their minds and for their souls, and contentment. Father, help them all to find rest in you, and Lord, bring a glimpse of your goodness to them, whether healing in full or contentment in the midst of it. We entrust this to you. Father, in your goodness, hear our prayer. Jesus, you came to seek and save the lost. Thank you. Thank you for coming to us. Thank you for enabling us to receive what is shared. It's only by your work on our hearts that this happens. So, Lord, we pray that you continue to work on our hearts, that your love leads us to always be looking for a way to talk about the gift that you've given us. Give us wisdom to see the opportunities within our homes, among our neighbors, among our coworkers, and the students we sit alongside. Father, in your goodness, hear our prayer. Jesus, you are the head of the church, and we as individuals, as part of a local church, are part of the body. You the head, we're the body. Thank you that we're not alone in this and that we have so many together and many and varied parts. Some are more like the hand and some more like the eye and some more like the foot or the knee or the heart. And so, Father, we pray that you continue to share and show your love in unique ways through each of us and help us fully be who you've made us to be. But Lord, we also lift before you, especially one of our partners in ministry, St. John's Lutheran Church, and Pastor Maureen Serchez. Thank you for the vibrancy you're bringing to the ministries there. Lord, thank you for the ways they're able to reach out to and connect with college students at Grand Valley University. Continue to open doors so that your good news is heard in Allendale, in Jenison, and at GVSU. Father, in your goodness, hear our prayer. Lord, the harvest is plentiful and the workers are few. Jesus, those were your words when you walked on this earth. Thank you for those who find joy in raising up more workers. Lord, thank you especially for the family ministry here at Holy Cross that enables us, that equips us to invest in the next generation, in our kids and in parents alike. We pray that families would use the family faith kits, the confirmation resources, and the videos that are customized and crafted to bless children from the youngest ages up through confirmation. Lord, we pray that the work of the youth groups and the gatherings that happen would create a fellowship and allow for sharing, that allows for growth in faith. Lord, enable parents to raise up the next generation of children that love and follow you. And Lord, we pray that kids and parents alike would be open to and would respond to your call in their lives to serve him, serve you most of all. Father, in your goodness, hear our prayer. Now, Father, for those loved ones about whom we care, those situations over which we have no control, and the burdens that we carry on our hearts, we lay them all before you, using the pattern that Jesus has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.